So today's video, I want to talk about a subset of problems in maths called orchard problems, which are not really to do with trees, but it's kind of helpful to think about trees. So you can think of apple trees or you can think about forest. Fruit trees, they're quite often planted in deliberate plantation way, so in lines. Have you ever seen, if you're driving down a road and there's a huge vineyard, you get this weird effect when you look down the vineyard and you see just a line of trees, and then suddenly you move a bit and you see that it stretches on forever. And as you move, you get this like coming in and out of phase, and it's quite a nice effect. Actually, there's a lot of maths to ask about these things, like which trees can you see at any one point and which trees can you not see, and can you see out of the orchard or are the trees in the way, and does it matter where you stand? And that's the sort of thing that often get described as orchard problems. And the one I want to show you, it's a simple one with a surprisingly unexpected answer. Imagine you're standing at the edge of an infinite forest or an orchard. This is a mathematical one, so the trees are thin and all the trees are on coordinate points. So if you imagine a coordinate grid, that they call this lattice points in the trade, the points with integer coordinates, so 1, 1, 1, 2. And I'm just gonna put loads of trees on this because this is gonna be where we're gonna play for a while. We're gonna play in the orchard for a bit. Let's start, as in all good mathematical models, by keeping it simple, and later on we could upgrade that. But so the simplest way is to assume that they're mathematically thin, they're points, which is obviously not what real trees do. But we'll ask questions about that before we upgrade the model to be more realistic.
Doesn't that mean we wouldn't be able to see them?
Well, kind of, but if you look directly at it, there is a tree there. And actually, that's what I want to start asking about, which trees can you see? So I'm going to imagine that for the sake of the rest of this argument, we're going to stand at the origin. And I could have done all the trees going over here and down here, but we'll just work with this quadrant and you can extend it in your own mind if you wish. And the real question is, if all these trees are out there and they carry on forever, this is an infinite forest, so it doesn't end in those directions. There are a lot of trees. I'm gonna just put that out there. There's possibly some level of infinity number of trees. And I think you can see some of them, although your caveat is noted that mathematically thin things are gonna be harder to see than real trees. But if I, for example, if I stand at this point and I look directly 45 degrees into the forest, I can see that tree. Like, if I get it right, I can see that tree. Obviously, if it's thin, maybe it's harder to see. But I also can't see the trees behind it because they're directly in line. So there are some obvious questions, which are not interesting yet, but about visibility. And so a lot of these problems are also called visibility problems or lattice problems. I like the more poetic orchard problems thing. Here's the question, and I'm going to ask you this, Brady. If you're standing at this corner, I'm going to claim that you can see some trees. For example, you can see that tree if you look in the right direction. You could also see that tree if you look along that direction. And you would then hide that tree and that tree behind it. So some directions you look, you can see trees, and I hope you agree with that. Is there any direction, Brady, that you could look, standing here into the forest, and not see a tree eventually? And I'm interested in your intuition about this.
My intuition is no.
Because eventually, if you go far enough, you'll hit one. Even if you like carve out to miss the first few of them, it goes on forever. Now, I have the same intuition about that. The answer is not as simple as that. The other standard answers to this question are, yeah, look up, no trees up there, which is great, it's hilarious. But if you look along the axes, there are trees on there as well. So I think it's obvious, I'm going to claim it's obvious, that you can see some trees. Is it all trees or are there gaps? And where are the gaps if there are any? And that's what we're going to play with because it's surprisingly easy to answer. So the first thing I'm going to point out is that I know which tree I can see based on what angle I look on the line. Actually, the angle is not so important as the gradient. So if you're standing here and you look along an angle of 45 degrees there, then you will see this tree, and that's got a coordinate of 1, 1. Now, actually, the 45 degrees is pretty intuitive, but it's also a gradient of 1. And just to remind you about a gradient, it's like how far along you go for, how far up you go for every 1 along. Rise over run is the gradient. This has got a gradient of 1 for every 1 along, you go 1 up. And this line here, I'm less worried about what the angle is. I could work it out, but I need some trigonometry. But I can tell you the gradient of that line, the gradient here equals 2. And it's hit the tree at 1, 2. So I'm gonna claim that if I know I'm gonna hit a tree, I can probably calculate the gradient of the line I hit. So if I picked this point here, is that gonna be a good one? Well, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 2 up. So it's the point 5, 2. And actually I can work out which line will hit it. Cause it's gotta go to there and it will carry on. But because I've got a line, I've got some distances, I can work out the gradient of this one is the rise over the run, which is gonna be 2/5. What's lovely is that I now know which lines will hit which trees. And if I find a tree I've hit, I also know the gradient of the line. I'm now wondering if your intuition has been adjusted from when I first asked. You said you wouldn't hit, you'd always hit a tree eventually, right? You worried that you wouldn't?
Well, if we can make a gradient out of, that's not made out of integers, Like
pi. Pi is one of those massively annoying numbers that turns up everywhere you don't expect. But there's just one example of a number now which would do what you've just claimed. It's not built of integers or in ratios of integers. And this is where they get the word rational, because of that ratio of integers. So rational would be better pronunciation, except no one uses that. Look, so these are all rational numbers. If I look along a rational gradient, I will hit a tree. So if you looked along a line of gradient, you said pi. Well, pi is close to 3. So the gradient is roughly 3, it would go...
I've just missed the 3 tree.
You just go above it, so it's 3.1-ish. So you kind of head up there, it would be something like this line. But it would miss that tree, and it would go up here. And it's not obvious to me where it would go next. Or, in fact, whether it would hit a tree. Unless I know something about pi, which you've kind of mentioned, that it is irrational. It's not a ratio. Now, if it was a ratio, it would hit a tree. Since it's not a ratio, it can't hit a tree.
So it's going to just miss the 22 over 7 tree.
It's going to be really close to it because it's ridiculously close to 22 over 7. Pi is really well approximated by that rational number. And there's some other really good ones too. But it is going to miss, because if it didn't miss, it would be a rational number. Now, there are lots of irrational numbers. They're pretty unintuitive things to exist, but we can prove they exist. As James has done a lovely video about root 2, that we think that's the first one that anyone realized. Ah, no ratio. And you can prove it, which means there are lines on this diagram that you could look along and you'll never see a tree. And that's the first answer. You're like, all right, so there are some lines that you won't ever see a tree despite this forest going on forever. And I kind of like that first result. It's like, ah, I can see lots of trees. In fact, infinitely many trees. But there are some lines I can look and never see a tree. So the real question is, if you pick a direction at random, are you likely to see a tree or are you gonna miss? And this is where my mind starts sort of complaining about things, because the answer is to do with how many numbers there are. How many trees can you see? Well, it's the same question as how many rational numbers are there. Everyone says infinitely many. It turns out the mathematicians have this nice way of talking about infinity of different sorts. So actually the rational numbers have a size of infinity, which is we call countable. James Grime, when he talks about it, quite often calls them listable, which is a nice way to think about it. You can't actually count them because you don't finish, but you can list them in a way that means you've captured them all. So we really have to ask, how many irrational numbers are there? Because if there's more, maybe we're more likely to miss a tree. Which is then we got to ask questions about, can you count the irrationals? And again, if you go and look into the study of infinity, look up work by George Cantor or a nice video by James Grime on an amazing maths YouTube channel, he explains to you why the irrational numbers are uncountable or unlistable, which means there are infinitely many more irrational numbers than rational numbers. Which means if you pick a direction at random in this forest, you probably miss all the trees. In fact, not even probably. Probability zero that you'll hit a tree. You are 100% going to always miss the trees, which means if you stand at the corner, mathematically, you can't see any trees because every direction you look, there are no trees. Except you can see some because we've picked out some, but there will be infinitely many more that you can never see, or lines which never hit a tree.
So if these trees are sort of super, super thin, where they're point thin,
yeah,
and I'm standing in the middle of the forest, I'm going to be ranged with light, not shade.
Yeah, yeah. It's all gaps. And this is completely irrational to sort of have a horrifying pun. These irrational numbers, they're so densely populated compared to the rationals that everywhere you look, you're likely to hit them, and not these special rationals, which are really rare in comparison. In fact, so rare that they account for 0% of all the numbers. But it still messes with my head that you can stand in a forest of infinite trees and not see any of them, which is where the mathematical model comes into question. Like, okay, because they're infinitely thin, you could say upgrade the model. You could say, well, what if the trees are a little bit thick? Or maybe if you think about this as firing a laser beam in your directions, then you can say, well, what if my laser beam is a little bit thick? And it's very easy to start realizing that eventually when the thickness comes in, you do get trees blocking the way. And you go into a forest, all you can see is trees, which is different from what we just explained. But the question is, how far can you see into the forest? And then suddenly we've got quite a real life question of like, well, how far does this laser actually get before it gets blocked by a tree? It will depend on thickness. It will depend on maybe the size of the orchard. And so those questions become orchard problems, and the famous one is Pollier's orchard problem, if you want to look it up. It's to do with how far can you see, or could you get out of the wood with your laser, depending on the size of the orchard.
I'm guessing that if the trees are 1 millimeter thick, suddenly you would have zero gaps on an infinite scale.
On an infinite scale, you're completely correct. That mathematically thin is the only reason you can see nothing, and as soon as there's any thickness, you can't get out at all. But there are some other interesting thoughts. It's like, on the infinite one, with mathematically thin trees, you could ask, instead of about the lines in this forest, you could ask about the points. So which points can you see? Which trees are visible in this forest? The ones all behind the 1-1 are invisible if you're standing at the corner. They're doomed to never be seen by any line because they're blocked by this one. But that point's visible, that one's not. So which points are, and maybe if you picked a point at random out of all of them, what are the chances you've picked a visible tree? Talking about picking random stuff from infinitely many things is dangerous mathematically. Actually, what we're talking about is if you make it finite, like n and n, and then answer that question when it's finite, and then let n head off to infinity. It turns out that you still have a sensible answer. The chance, I'm going to tell you this, the chance of a visible tree, if you pick one at random, and this blows my tiny mind, is 6 over pi squared. Another instance of pi turning up in the place you least expect it. But this is because of something called the Riemann zeta function, which I think there are other videos available about. And it's because of the fact that if you actually want a visible tree, what you need is the tree you've picked to have two numbers, the coordinates here, which are coprime. Because if they weren't coprime, if they had common factors, they'd be hidden by an earlier tree. So what we're actually asking is, like, the chance of picking a visible tree is actually an abstract mathematical question. Pick two numbers at random, what are the chances they're coprime? The answer is the Riemann zeta function with s equals 2. Look it up, and it turns out to be this thing. It's not obvious why that's the case, but the Riemann zeta function is a treasure trove of non-obvious mathematical stories.
So if I was allergic to apple trees, and I wanted to walk out of this forest without going near one, what is the best line to walk along?
I'm going to disappoint you. First of all, you're going to go near one. But maybe there's a line which is least near. It's still going to be near, I'm going to... And maybe you could argue mathematically you're going to get pretty damn close. But anyway, the idea that there may be a line which is least near means there's a most irrational number. And actually, it is this line, for reasons I'm not going to go into now, but there are some interesting familiarities about it. So here's my little computer screen of some trees. This line is at a gradient of precisely 1 plus the square root of 5 all over 2, which, if it's not familiar to you, you probably heard it by a different name. It's called the golden ratio. It's roughly 1.618. Obviously, if I told you the full decimal would be here for longer than you want to watch video. This golden ratio turns up in lots of places, and it is the line that dodges the most trees. And it's not easy to show in this case, but
there are lots of lines that dodge all the trees.
In fact, infinitely many, but this one seems to be furthest away because we know something about the golden ratio, which is that it's the least well approximated by a rational number, which means in this case, it's the line that's least near any tree. And one thing you can see nicely about this, if you imagine this line in the middle is the golden ratio gradient, and you imagine it was an elastic band going off to infinity, and you pulled this end along, it would catch on these trees, and if you pulled it up, it would catch on some other trees. And it turns out that these numbers are familiar. This is the coordinate 1-1, this is the coordinate 1-2, this is the coordinate 2-3, the next one it hits is 3-5. Those numbers I'm reeling off are all from the Fibonacci sequence. In fact, all the trees that this elastic band catches on are the numbers from the Fibonacci sequence. And that's another reason why the Fibonacci sequence captures in its ratios the golden ratio. It's a very intriguing number, which we should explore a bit more in another video.
Well, orchards might cause some problems, but one thing that shouldn't cause a problem is designing a website, not if you use Squarespace. This is a service I use every day for various blogs, podcasts, e-commerce, and if you want to do anything online, you should be checking them out too. They've got superb templates that makes designing your site easy, although you can tweak it to get it how you want it. Any site you design automatically scales perfectly on a computer or a tablet or a phone. You don't have to think about that stuff. They've also got brilliant customer support. The best thing to do is just go and have a look, go and have a play and see how easy it is. Go to squarespace.com/numberphile, and if you do that, you'll get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. That's squarespace.com/numberphile. Our thanks to them for supporting this episode.